Good afternoon, everybody. And I want to also congratulate the organizers for switching the conference in so short period from the real platform to the virtual platform. And of course, for giving the opportunity to talk to you all now. And I will talk here about the work which we have been doing for many years, together with the lab in Leeds, which is headed by Professor Anthony Turner, and also in the Institute of Sechenov Institute, in the laboratory headed by Dr. Igor Zhuravin. Okay. Why cannot I change? Oh, yeah. What is epigenetic regulation? It refers to the changes in the phenotype of cells and organisms which are not rooted in DNA sequence. It is a process of controlling the levels of gene expression in response to various endogenous and external stimuli and factors. The nervous system consists of a huge number of cells, up to 100 billion in humans, which differentiate and specialize during development under the control of a combination of numerous transcription factors. And some of them are working only during development, while others act in the adult nervous system, maintaining functions and differentiation of cells. Epigenetic regulation of neuronal genes is a very important process for normal brain development, as I already said, and functioning. For example, for synaptic plasticity diseases, for example, in Alzheimer's disease, which I will be talking about later. So what are the levels of epigenetic regulation? First of all, Bell studied this DNA methylation, which causes silencing of genes. And there are several post-translation histone modifications. The main of them I've listed here. The most studied is acetylation, then methylation, phosphorylation, sumoylation, and more recently discovered crotonylation, which is very important for spermatogenesis, but also was found in kidney disorders and also in depression and other diseases. And lactylation, also a new form of modification of histones, was found to be responsible for glucose metabolism and also for response of cells to hypoxia. There is also the cohort of transcription factors, several thousand of those. And there are also ATP-dependent chromatin remodelers, which are more complex structures, which changes the modification of chromatin, the structure of the whole chromatin nucleosome and high levels compactization. There are also in the cells non-coding RNAs, and the list is growing fast now, and they are determining the fate of mRNAs in the cells and also the protein synthesis. There are also chaperones and proteins, which were shown to act very fast as a very fast platform for changing one cell, can tell another cell how to act further, and it's very fast the process, which also affects epigenetic status of other cells and also chromatin modeling of other cells. And also recently it was studied microbiota. It was very found that our microbes are very important for the whole our genome because they can also change expression of different genes. So, and to study all this, of course, all this regulation and all these epigenetic changes, we need tools. And of course, optogenetics is not that yet well was developed for studying epigenomic changes. And if you look in the PubMed, for example, from 5,000 references which are dedicated to optogenetics, there are only about 20 where optogenetics and epigenetics were studied together. Anyway, the most recently developed CRISPR-Cas9 system is quite widely used now for silencing or targeting different genes. And it can be also used for targeting or the linker with histone acetyltransferases can be linked to certain loci on DNA and can act as histone acetylases of histone located on this gene and just change their status by acetylation of their tails. So this is a very important process because you can find a specific DNA sequence and acetylate histones nearby. But of course, you need for to detect all these changes, you need some chemical and photo light inducible editing. And there are several small molecules for chemical and photo transducers to change the status of the chromatin in the cell. So you can detect all these changes at the level of the cell or organism. So how does epigenetic regulation act as the chromatin level? DNA methylation and demethylation, as I told already, results in the silencing of gene because it closes nucleosome structure and chromatin become less accessible to transcription factors and regulators. And these enzymes which remove acetylation or put methylation marks on the DNA called writers. Called erasers, because they erase the signal which is caused by acetylation of histones. Histone acetylase transferases are called writers because they put these acetylation marks on the histones and they relax chromatin structure, allowing transcription factors, which are called readers, to bind to the sequence of this and make transcription of chromatin of genes possible. So there are also certain compounds like HDAC inhibitors, which we can use to stop the process of demethylation acetylation of histones, and as such, leave this open space allowing cells and transcription factors to act on the chromatin and on DNA, and to keep this function of cells more long and or just change it and the transcription factors and see what is happening with the cell and expression of various genes. One of the most important transcription factors, which is important for adult brain and development especially, is Notch signaling. Notch is a transmembrane protein, the receptor, which in response to various ligands and under effect of proteases, which are seated on this result in the cleavage and production of C-terminal fragment, which is called NIC, stages of disease, and mostly affect cortical and hippocampal area. Alzheimer's disease is a very complex disorder. There is a genetic form of disease, which is very early onset, at age of 20 can be, in the families which have these specific mutations. Some of mutations are in the APP gene, the amyloid precursor protein gene, and some are mutations in presenilin genes. And these presenilins are proteins which are inside the gamma secretase complex, which are components of gamma secretase complex, which are cleavage amyloid precursor protein producing A-beta peptide. There are some other loci probably which are still unknown, but there are lots of studies of genetic studies involved in deciphering the disease. There is also the late onset Alzheimer's disease, which strikes people after 65 years. And there are many, many risk factor genes which can predispose to the development. ApoE lipoprotein E epsilon 4 is one of the most studied, but there are also TREM2, BIN, and so on. Also ADAM10, which is alpha secretase, and many other proteins. And it is also interesting to know that there are not only mutations which predispose to development of Alzheimer's disease, but also there are mutations, for example, in APP gene, which makes this bearers of this mutation more, you know, agile, and they live to very, very long age without any cognitive disorders or dementia. So now about APP itself. APP is also transmembrane protein and presents in all cells, and there are APP itself and two APP-like proteins. This is their distribution in the body. This is how they look in the membrane. Knockouts of APP or APP LPP1 or LPP2 are viable, but double mutation or triple mutation knockout, they are lethal embryonically, so these animals do not survive. So APP itself, there are three isoforms. The shortest one, APP695, is typically neuronal and it's found in neurons, while the long isoforms are typical for astroglia and also to somatic cells. And it's very important to bear in mind this scheme because I will be using these isoforms later to explain how we look at the regulation of neprilysin. So what is amyloid precursor protein processing? 5% of this protein is processed by that way. It acts by alpha secretase, which is ADAM, disintegrin and metalloprotease protein sitting on the plasma membrane, which cleaves this APP within the I-beta sequence, preventing its formation. It releases very large extracellular soluble APP domain, which has neurotrophic and neuroprotective functions. When EPP is cleaved by beta secretase, which are aspartic protease also sitting in the membrane. This is cleavage starts here, and then by gamma secretase, then there is release of I-beta, and also C-terminal domain, similar to NICD, which I told you about already, and called similarly ICD. ICD can also be, can be produced in alpha secretase pathway, but it doesn't have that particular role about I will talk about, because it's mostly plasmic and it's very quickly dysregulated. So a beta has propensity to aggregate into aggregates and then into plaques. And the most recent work in this year work showing that using this a beta peptide with this optogenetic probe, which was under effect of blue light, can self-aggregate very quickly. And using this model in Drosophila, it was found that this aggregation of a beta peptide leads to the reduction of the number of mitochondria and also the redox potential and respiration of the cell is significantly reduced. So although there are not so many papers with approach epigenetic optogenetic approach to study Alzheimer's disease, apart from the work which we have heard today from Alla Borisovna Salmina, this work shows clearly that you can use optogenetic approach to study A-beta metabolism and also pathogenesis of Alzheimer's disease. So for Alzheimer's disease, it's important if A-beta plays this pathological role, it's very important to get rid of it. And indeed in the brain, there is a cohort of amyloid degrading enzymes which can cleave it. There is also perivascular drainage, which peptide can be removed from the brain. It can be, you know, digested by microglia and macrophage. There is a transport protein transthyretin, which can sequester A-beta from the brain, and this low-density lipoprotein and upper lipoprotein E, which can also bind A-beta and remove it from the brain. So, and now there is a view that the late onset Alzheimer's disease is a failure of all this A-beta clearance mechanism rather than increased A-beta production. So the question arises, can we upregulate A-beta degrading enzymes like neprilysin? Here, this is the sequence of A-beta peptide, and the, here I showed all these potential, not potential, real enzymes we are in the brain, which can cleave it. The major amyloid degrading enzyme is neprilysin, and it was shown that if you inhibit it, you have accumulation of A-beta in the brain, and if you insert an epigene into cells or in the brain, you can clear amyloid beta peptides from the transgenic mice model. Also, these enzymes are distributed evenly through all the brain. They are sitting on the neurons, in the synapses, in the axons, in the glia, in astrocytes, dendrites, in the stellate cells. So lots of them, and why they fail? Why they fail to clear amyloid peptide? And this is because under during the lifespan of animals and cells, the levels of expression of these proteins and their changes, and they changes under epigenetic regulators such as stress, hypoxia, and other stimuli. So, what is neprilysin? It is a neutral endopeptidase, most abundant in the kidneys. In the brain, it is located pre and postsynaptically and axonally in neurons. And actually, recently, Chris Ekman groups showed that the main location in the neurons, it's in the GABAergic neurons, which shows that maybe neprilysin is important for you know, inhibition processes in the brain. NEP has broad substrate specificity and cleaves such regulatory peptides and cephalin substance P, atrial natriuretic peptides. It's sitting, as I said already, pre and postsynaptically, and it cleaves, as it was shown, it cleaves encephalin, and it was also known as encephalinase. And then it was also shown that NEP is also a major amyloid degrading enzyme and suggesting that amyloid beta peptide also under normal condition is a regulatory peptide and it has mechanism of its terminating of its signal. Neprilysin also plays a role in cardiovascular system, in cancer, in immune response, in pain, and as I told you already, inhibition results in accumulation of it in the brain. So in our studies, which we've done, this is our some most recent study, which we've done in the Sechenov Institute, we've shown that NEP expression in different brain structures significantly changes during lifespan of rats. You can see that in parietal cortex, cortex, entorhinal cortex, hippocampus, after 1 month of development, although it is quite highly expressed during the first month, the level of expression of neprilysin is decreased significantly. It's quite high in striatum, and actually in striatum there no was detected any of amyloid plaques. It's also quite high in our olfactory bulbs, although it's with aging, it's decreasing as well, and it also plays a role in the loss of olfactory sensation in old animals. So this is also the protein level. You can see that in the cortex, NAP levels, protein levels are decreased, and in the striatus stay quite high. And if you look at this NAP activity and correlation with the memory of animals, you can see that old animals which have low activity, they have more errors in the testing when they tested in the maize to 8 arms to level maize. And also young animals which were predisposed to prenatal hypoxia, they also have quite significant deficit of memory at the age of 3 months, and they also have low levels of NAP expression. Actually, we've done also experiments when we injected tyserophone, that their memory starts to suffer. Can we upregulate NAP expression? Yes, and the story, because we know that ICD plays a similar role as an ICD, potentially, because it's eclipsed by similar machinery, should have some role in the cells. So our colleague in Nice, Frederic Clair, with this was also Rafaela Pardosi-Picard, they suggested that probably ICD can go to the nucleus and can bind to some target genes. And they looked at the NAP gene, and they have found, and it was synthetic system, cell system, they found, yes, potentially ICD binds to NAP and upregulates it. But other laboratories could not repeat these experiments, and this question was hung in the air for quite a long time. And then we decided that to check, let's do this. And we were very lucky to have in our lab two cell lines, NB7 and SHSY cells, which have different expression of neprilysin. NB7 has very high level of expression of NAP, and SHSY5Y, they have very low level of expression. The protein level, this mRNA, the activity, and also the different APP and physical ICD expression in the cells. So what we have done, using chromatin immunoprecipitation technique, we looked what happens in the promoter of the genes. And we have found that in SHSY5Y cells, which have very low level of NAP expression, there is a GDAC occupancy on the NAP promoter on both of them. You see it's very high there in the cells. And in NB7 cells, there is ICD sitting on its promoter, on both promoters actually. And it also correlates with acetylation of histone 16, lysine 16 and 8 in histone H4. So everything looks so nice. So in the cells which have high level of expression of NAP, we have ICD sitting on the promoter, and in the low level expressing cell, there is histone deacetylase sitting on the promoter. And if you look at them cytochemically, you can detect that ICD in the cell, in the cell nucleus and NB7 cells is very brightly colored here in the nucleus, why in SHSY5Y, there is not so much colocalization of the signals. So we went further and we looked at what would be effect of histone deacetylase inhibitors like valproic acid or tricostatin A. And we found, yes, if you look in NB7 when expression is high, we cannot change the level of expression and cannot make it higher. But in SHSY5Y cell, yes, we can upregulate expression of neprilysin at the enzyme activity and also an NAP activity level. And it also correlates with the increased occupancy of AICD on the promoter and decrease of HDAC1. And we also have found that if we express different isoforms of APP, only in this neuronal APP isoform, we can have NAP mRNA expression activation by ICD. And actually, this process is inhibited by gamma secretase. So if we inhibit gamma secretase, we reduce expression of NAP. And also we can reduce expression of NAP by using beta secretase, but not alpha secretase inhibitors, which shows this process is activated by amyloid pathway of APP proteolysis. And this is important because it gives us perfect feedback mechanism. When more A-beta is produced and ICD produced in A-beta, there is more ICD which can go to the nucleus and upregulate expression of APP, of NAP, and cleave amyloid beta peptide. So NAP is upregulated only by ICD formed in the amyloidogenic pathway. This is a wonderful idea. And also what we have found that this process is specific for neuronal cells only. If we overexpress APP in kidney cells, we do not have any upregulation of NAP. But if we use other neuronal cells, we can again upregulate expression of NAP with APP695. So we started to look at the animal models and decided to look what would be the effect of valproate on our animal model of animals which are subject to prenatal hypoxia and have very low NAP expression already at 3 months. Yes. And we use this valproate, which was very well known as anti-epileptic drug. It practically has no side effects, was used for 40 years. And so it was, although it has quite a wide substrate HDAC, you know, inhibitory activity, we still saw that we can just target our neprilized zin promoter with this drug. And actually what we have found, yes, in these animals in the cortex and hippocampus of hypoxic animals, we have lower level of expression of NAP. And after treating them for 2 weeks with valproic acid, we can upregulate expression of NAP, and each coincide with their improved performance in the two-level maze and also in novel object recognition test, but data not here shown. And what it corresponds to, as we found while it was chromatin immunoprecipitation, that yes, in valproic treated animals, we have increased ICD occupancy on the promoter of NAP. So in parallel with our work, there was a work of a Canadian group by Hyun Song. They showed that if they treated Alzheimer model mice with valproic acid, they also have decreased amount of amyloid plaques and also improved morphology of neuronal cells, although they did not look at what happened with neprilysin. And we showed in our work that neprilysin is indeed upregulated by effect of valproic acid. But another question raises why neprilysin expression is reduced after hypoxia. This, you can see this NB7 cells, model cells are, which we use very wide in our lab. And in control cells, there's high expression of NAP in green. And this is located mostly on the membrane of the cells. And quite little of these red dots, which are GLUT1, and this is glucose transporter 1, which is a marker of hypoxia. When you put cell for 24 hours, 1% of oxygen, you can see that there is practically no NAP, very, very little spots here, and quite significantly upregulation of glucose transporter 1. And indeed, in the cells, we have reduced NAP levels and also reduced binding of ISCD to the promoter of NAP in the cells. So how it could happen, why it's so few ISCDs binding to the promoter in hypoxic cells? And then from literature, from our own data, we know that ICD is prone to be digested by many, many enzymes in the cells, and it's also a good substrate for caspases. And what we looked in this NB7 cells and found that after hypoxia, caspase 1, 8, and 9 upregulated, and caspase activity as well. And if we treat the cells with caspase inhibitor, we can restore expression and activity of neprilysin. So we also moved to our animal model and looked at our hypoxic animals. And we found that yes, it did, after prenatal hypoxia on 40th day of gestation, when the nervous system is forming in its most active rate, there is very high upregulation of caspase during all this lifespan of animals during 2 months. And also this is an increased levels of NAP activity there. And also there is also reduced ICD protein levels, also reduced NAP level. And when we treat the animals with caspase inhibitor, we can upregulate NAP expression. And also it restores levels of ICD. So interesting proof of concept work shown that some data which you find in animal and cell studies, you can then translate into animals and see very similar results. So similarly, we also looked at our NB7 cells and treated them with epigallic catechin gallate, which is catechin and green tea, and which also was shown can act as histone deacetylase inhibitors. And we also have found that in hypoxic animals, in hypoxic cells, where NAP epigallic catechin gallate upregulates expression and activity of NAP in the cells. And similarly, when we treat our hypoxic rats also with epigallic catechin gallate, this is the hypoxic animals, we see that their level of expression and activity of NAP is lower in the cortex and in the hippocampus. And when you treat cells, animals with epigallic catechingalate, we can upregulate expression practically to the level of control animals, which also were treated with epigallic catechingalate, shows that for healthy animals, it's also quite beneficial to receive epigallic catechingalate, because with age, you can just keep a regulation of NAP at a quite high level. So these animals had improved performance in the novel object recognition test. They spent more time exploring novel object compared to the hypoxic animals, which were quite dull. And also there are number of errors in the eight-arm maze was also improved. It was reduced. And we also have found that it corresponds with the number of synaptopodin positive dendritic spines in the cortex after injection of both epigallic catechingalate, both intracortically or per os. So are there any other genes which we can regulate with APP-ICD fragment? Yes, we found that similarly to NAP, there is a transthyretin protein which participates in the transport of A-beta, can also be regulated similarly. You can see that APP-695 isoform increases expression in SHSY5L cells, and it corresponds with decreased level of histone deacetylase binding to the promoter and with increased binding of ICD promoters to ICD to NAP and TTR promoters in our cell models. So we were looking also for new HDAC inhibitors, which actually quite widely used for treating various diseases, especially in cancer, from our university, Leeds University, Ron Grieg, who designed this inhibitor to treat several types of cancers. And when we looked in our cells, we also found that inhibiting HDAC3, we can also upregulate expression of neprilysin in our cells. And quite recently, it was found that treating Alzheimer's model mice with S3 inhibitor also reverses the phenotype, Alzheimer phenotype, and it also correlates with increased expression of neprilysin in these animals. But story is not that simple, because when we looked what APP does to histone deacetylases themselves, we have found that actually it changes its expression of HDACs. In all our cell models, expressing all isoforms, you can see that this decreased level of HDAC1 expression and decreased level of HDAC3 in these cells. It shows that overexpression of human APP in the cells will result in changes in histone deacetylases level. And this is very important to bear in mind, because all these animal transgenic models, they have overexpressed human APP in their brains. And so these animals also will have different completely machinery of histone deacetylases. We don't know how it will act, because it would be important to look how all these changes in histone deacetylases affect the machinery and epigenetics in the brain of these transgenic mice. And maybe optogenetics new methods will help us to do this. The story is even more difficult, because recently it was found that amyloid beta peptide is not junk which accumulates and makes the senile plaques. It is a peptide. It's definitely a regulatory peptide, but still we have to find its role. And it can also regulate the gene expression. It was found that it was regulate expression of growth factors, early immediate genes, and this S4 gene. So if A beta is also regulatory peptide, also transcription factor, then we cannot just completely erase it from the brain. It is required. So we just only know exactly what its role and what physiology it does have. So what is our view on the A-beta metabolism now? So this is the machinery of the cells, gamma secretase and the complex, which also is involved in notch signaling. And it is important to formation of this IACD transcription factor, which activates expression of various genes. Now the list of this is quite high. It's about 40 genes, which were already shown to be regulated by ICD, including aquaporin, IPP, BASE. It's actually down-regulates the epidermal growth factor, and it not also upregulates, but also decreases expression of some factors. Interestingly, all this machinery is under effect of environmental factors, stress, trauma, everything, diet, exercise. Actually, exercise improves NAP expression in the brain, and like hypoxic ischemia, as we have found, and also infection can cause to change all this machinery and lead either to downregulation of NAP or overexpression of amyloid beta peptide. So we need optogenetics approaches to study all these processes to make sure that we know exactly what is happening, what is the role of all these participants of all this pathway, and how we can manipulate them for the benefit of the society. So to take, or better say, to stay at home message, dural gene expression, and in particular those involved ID pathology, changes during individual lifespan and is regulated by various internal and external factors. And they determine the levels of the activity and can predispose to neurodegeneration, especially of Alzheimer's disease type. And understanding mechanism of amyloid-degrading enzymes, so clearance proteins regulation, is one of the perspectives to protect the brain against amyloid-related pathology sites, such as late-onset Alzheimer's disease. So we focus mostly on amyloid-degrading enzymes, mainly on NAP, but we also study other enzymes like insulin-degrading enzyme, which is also changes with, it also reduces with age in the brain, also endothelin-converting enzyme, and many other enzymes. And of course, studies of APP interactome, what it actually regulates and how, is essential for understanding its normal functions and the role of its products in development of neurodegeneration and Alzheimer's disease. Opto and chemogenetic techniques, I'm sure, are essential for further progress in Alzheimer's research. And this is a group in Leeds who are doing this work. And this is all our colleagues in Sechenov Institute who are involved in this work in different times in space and in time. And this is all the funding bodies who we supported our work. Thank them very much for that. And now I want to invite you next year. I hope that we overcome COVID-19 pandemic and we will all meet next year in May in St. Petersburg at the 24th ASN biennial meeting and AIDS conference on molecular and cellular mechanism of regulation in the nervous system. We are all very cordially invited to that meeting. I hope we will live face to face, not via internet. And also in my capacity as the president of this society of ASN, I would be very happy to see you as ASN members. If you are not yet a member of ASN, please join us. Annual fee is only €25, but it simultaneously gives you membership in the International Society for Neurochemistry and FENS, and you can access Journal of Neurochemistry, European Journal for Neuroscience, and attend all the meetings and be involved in all the schemes which the society support. Many thanks for your attention, and I'm happy to take your questions.
Natalia, thank you very much for your excellent presentation. We knew many new things. And now we are waiting for questions. And I think some of them we already have. Kira?
Friends, if you have any questions, raise your hand, please. Professor Burzhestovsky asks, what is the mechanism of chronodegeneration?
Mechanism of crotonylation, this is a crotonyl, it's a so the derivative, it's one of metabolite of butyryl on or other amino acids, and it is forms crotonyl coenzyme A, which is like acetyl coenzyme A, can crotonylate various proteins, including the lysines in histones. It's a quite a new novel mechanism, which has only recently was discovered, and it's very, very actively studied.
Thank you.
Okay. Karen Simonian asks, DNA methylation of the AB hippocampus.
Sorry, can you repeat, please?
DNA methylation in the AD hippocampus.
Yeah, there are works about DNA methylation in hippocampus of Alzheimer's disease. There was shown that there are some correlations, the level of DNA methylation and the significance and the stages of development of the disease. Yeah. It is important.
Okay.
Okay, other questions, please? So.
Okay, Peter.
Yes.
Yes, you can hear me. Okay, so actually about proic acid, this is actually very interesting. It seems to me that you can produce a regulation of that one on the level. It is known actually that it is working on the dark. But what would you recommend it to use it against the Alzheimer's disease?
Actually, when we published the studies, and there were quite a lot of backwards sort of epigenetic studies, not epigenetics, how do you call it, clinical, look at the clinical metadata, and there were actually in American population, and it was found that the people It was not statistically significant. We also looked at this with our colleagues in Moscow, in the Institute of Neuropsychology, and they showed also that indeed patients who were treated with valproic acid in the past, they have less frequency developing dementia and Alzheimer's disease. And it was also this metadata some groups showed in America, but because, you know, the cohort of people, they were able to, because not all records of people, of course, were available, so the cohorts were not very large. And to get a clear cut in that answer for that equation, it was not possible. But there definitely, there is a tendency in people who are taking valproic acid that they're less prone to development of Alzheimer's disease. But to answer to that completely and determinedly, we need a very huge study to make that.
Oh, yeah. Right. That's because it's using the epilepsy.
But what I can tell you that similarly, green tea catechins, they will also have similar effects. This is why to drink green tea is very good for you during all your life. And this is one of the mechanisms maybe. But what is interesting, when we were looking, because you know that recently neprilysin inhibitors are used to regulate blood pressure. And it was when the companies found that neprilysin inhibition can cause Alzheimer's disease, they stopped producing them. But now there are new generation of inhibitors which cannot penetrate to the brain and they can still use them. But what is interesting that drinking green tea, or at least in animals which were treated with epigallocatechin gallate, we had upregulation of NAP in the brain, but in the blood, the level of NAP was lower. So you can, you know, stabilize your blood pressure on one hand, and you can improve your neprilysin in the brain. But you know, of course, to have this effect, you probably need to drink green tea all your life.
Okay, I am going to have some green tea just now.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Okay, and we have two more questions, I think. Kira, please.
Так, Ксения Лапшина. Спасибо большое за доклад, Наталья Николаевна. В докладе упомянуто влияние на аквапарин. Имеется в виду аквапарин 4?
Yes, it is aquaparin 4.
Вопрос от Карена Симонян. Так, epigenetic regulation of neuro... Ой, скакнули. Neuroinflammation in Alzheimer's disease, the physiological...
Physiological mechanism.
Mechanism.
So.
Can you read it again? Because I started to read myself in the chat.
So Karen asks about physiological mechanisms of epigenetic regulations of neuroinflammation in Alzheimer's disease.
Yes, you know that, yes, of course, neuroinflammation plays a very important role in Alzheimer's disease because it promotes development, because it disrupts machinery of autophagy. But from the other hand, inflammation increases in glia expression of attack cells against accumulation of A beta and more harmful effect also on neuronal cells. There are some such studies, and it's, of course, I think nobody looked at in much detail in the role of neprilysin in neuroinflammation, although it is important because neprilysin plays a role in inflammation and immune response in the blood. So it definitely plays a similar role in the brain. And it is very important to look after.
Okay, thank you. And I think probably the last questions from Daria Mishalkina. So we turn on the sounds for you, so you can ask by yourself.
Thank you for your very informative report. In your opinion, does NEP functioning also depend on glucose metabolism? What is the connection between these regulation of adipose processing and, for example, their diabetes? Mm-hmm.
There are no direct links between NAP and diabetes, and I don't think anybody looked in much detail on that. Although insulin degrading enzymes, which also participate in A-beta metabolism, was looked at this and this. And of course, disruption of insulin metabolism is also important for development of Alzheimer's disease. And Alzheimer's disease sometimes called diabetes type 3 diabetes. So yes, neprilysin, I'm not sure if it is actually playing important role, but insulin degrading enzyme, which is another amyloid degrading enzyme, plays important role in pathogenesis of AD. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Natalia, thank you very much. And I think we have to applaud to your to your speech and to your answer to questions. And
thank you very much. Yes, thanks everyone for your attention. Thank you.
I think everybody can do it. Use this.